Welcome back. Welcome to part two. I want to finish up from where we left off. I believe we left off in Romans chapter 6, verse 13. Let's start there. Romans chapter 6, verse 13. Again, we're talking about justifying sin, how we should not justify sin, that God is the only one that is able to justify sin because he's God and because he is able to apply his son's blood to our lives, and that is the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Romans 6, verse 13, it says, neither yield you your members, talking about your mortal body, neither yield your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin. Don't yield your members, don't yield your bodies to sin. Don't yield your life to sin. Don't submit yourself to sin, something that goes against the knowledge of God, that goes against the word of God, the word of truth. Is what Paul is saying to the Romanians. It says, as instruments of unrighteousness. What is unrighteousness? Unrighteousness is doing the opposite of the word of God. So we know that righteousness, God's righteousness, is living according to the word of God, right? So unrighteousness is not living according to the word of God. As instruments of unrighteousness unto sin. Talking about the sin nature. Excuse me. Talking about the sin nature. But it says, but yield, which means to submit, but yield yourselves unto God. So we don't want to yield ourselves to the flesh. But instead, the Bible says in Colossians 3:5, it says that I may mortify. That means to kill, to put to death, mortify the members of my body. Right? So I'm supposed to mortify the members of my body. I'm not supposed to yield myself to sin, but yield myself to the word of God. Yield myself to God's will. Yield myself to God, the Bible says, to righteousness. As those who are alive from the dead. And your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. Look at verse 14 here. For sin shall not have dominion over you. Sin shall not have dominion over you. I prophesy in the name of Jesus. I declare by the power of the Holy Ghost in my own life, in your life, in the name of Jesus, that sin will not rule over us, but that we will rule over sin through the power of the blood of Jesus. In Jesus' name, that we may bring pleasure to the Father. Romans 8:7 says that our flesh is an enemy of God. So I can't please my flesh in that way. I can't please my flesh in any way that is unpleasant to the Father. Are you guys hearing what I'm saying here? For sin shall not have dominion over you. I want to remind you that you have the greater power. You have the greater power. You have the greater power. What is that greater power? That greater power is called the power of the Holy Ghost. The power of God. In the name of Jesus. That is what we use to overcome sin. Again, I believe I said this in the other part, part one. Fast if you need to. Read the word of God. The word of God shows you what's the difference between flesh and sin and the spirit and all these other things. The word of God teaches you what is right and what is wrong. Secondly, get in prayer. Getting power, activating that power that lives on the inside of me, which is the Holy Spirit, that I may overcome sin. Thirdly, fast. Fasting brings our flesh to the forefront. It shows me, it reveals in me what is in me. It reveals to me what is in me, what needs to come out. Fasting helps crucify this flesh. It kills what's in me that is not of God. For sin shall not have dominion over you. Let me read this note to you. The sin nature will not have dominion over us if we as believers continue to exercise faith in the cross of Christ. Otherwise, the sin nature most definitely will have dominion over the believer. Let me read the next part of verse 14. It says, for you are not under the law. Let me read the note to you for that I have in my Bible. For you are not under the law. What does that mean? Let me read it to you. Means that if we try to live this life by any type of law, no matter how good that law might be in its own right, we will conclude by the sin nature having dominion over us. Let me read the next part of verse 14 to you. Let me just start over here for you. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, watch this, but under grace. What is grace? It is the unmerited favor of God. It is the ability of God that comes through the Holy Spirit to help me live according to the word of God, to help me to walk in this righteousness that we're reading about in the scriptures. That is what grace is. It is the ability of God to be able to overcome sin. Not give me license to sin, but to overcome sin. That is the true grace of God. The Bible says that grace will abound even the more than sin, which means that grace is greater than and more powerful than the powers of sin in your life. The grace of God is able to break that stronghold. That snake of sin in you that has you bound and gripped. Hallelujah. Let me move on here because I have some couple of verses that I want to get through. It says, but under grace, let me read this to you. The grace of God flows to the believer on an unending basis only as long as the believer exercises faith in Christ and what he did at the cross. Grace is merely the goodness of God exercised by and through the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, and given to undeserving saints. Oh my goodness, God give us grace even though we don't deserve it. But through the blood of Jesus, I'm qualified for the grace of God. Verse 15, what then, Paul says? So he's going back to verse 1 because verse 1 in chapter 6 in Romans, it says, what shall we then? So now he's restating what he said in verse 1 in verse 15. He says, what then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law but under grace? God forbid, he says in verse 15. God forbid. God forbid. Let me read this note to you. If we think such a thing, then we're a completely misunderstanding grace. The grace of God gives us the liberty to live a holy life. The Bible says, I believe it's 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 16. Be holy, for I am a holy God. Be separate from the world. Come out from among them. Be ye separate, be ye holy. Oh, for I am a holy God. Thank you, Jesus. Which we do through faith in Christ and the cross, and not license, watch this, and not license to sin as some think. Grace is not for you to sin, but grace is for you to overcome sin. Go and sin no more, the Bible says. Go and sin no more. God cannot condone sin. God cannot condone sin. But he can justify it, or he can condone it through the blood of Jesus. But without the blood, he can't condone it. Which means that God can just watch us sin against him and go against his word. And he's just going to say, oh, it's okay. I love you. The devil is a liar. He has to judge sin. God hates sin. You need to hate. I need to hate what God hates. Hallelujah. Again, he destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah because of sin. and he warned them, but he spared them not. He only spared Abraham and Lot and the other ones that was with Abraham. That's in Genesis chapter 19. But let me move on here. I have about 10 minutes left. Let me read the latter part of verse 15. It says, God forbid. Let me read this note to you. Every true believer hates sin. So the idea of living under its dominion is abhorrent. What does abhorrent mean? It means awful or detestable. Awful. It's terrible to live under sin like that. So the idea of living under its domain is abhorrent, to say the least. Verse 16. Know you not that to whom you yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants. Servants means slaves or slave. His servants you are to whom you obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. So we, so we don't want to be servants. We don't want to be slaves. We don't want to be obedient to sin. But I want to be obedient to God through righteousness, lining my life up with the word of God, that I may have access or inherit the kingdom of God. Sin is not allowed in the kingdom of God. So therefore, I must be separate, come out from among sin and those who are in sin. Amen to that. Or of obedience unto righteousness. We want to walk in obedience to righteousness. What is righteousness again? Righteousness is living right according to the word of God. Verse 17 here. But God be thanked. Thank God that you were the servants of sin. Past tense. The word were is past tense. Thank God that we don't no longer live a life of sin. That we have come over into newness of life. That you are the servants of sin, but you have obeyed from the heart. You must obey the word of God from your heart. It is the heart that the Bible says in the Gospels, in the four Gospels, that God will judge. He's coming back to judge your motives. What is your motives linked to? Your heart. What is your motives? Your heart. In so many words. But you have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered you. So he's saying that the word of God was delivered to you. It was preached unto you. For you have obeyed that, for you have come from the old man to the new man because of what has been taught to you. And what was taught to you was the word of God. Let me read this note to you first. Then we'll move on to verse 18. Jesus Christ and him crucified, understanding that all things come to the believer from God by the means of the cross. Everything comes through the blood of Jesus. Verse 18. Being then made free from sin. So I'm not in bondage no more. We're not in bondage. This is what Paul is saying in the book of Romans. This is how our lives should be living. We are no longer under sin. We should no longer be under sin is what he's saying. Being then made free from sin, you became the servants of righteousness. I want to stress to you in my own self, let's become servants. Let's become slaves of righteousness. What is righteousness? It is living according to the word of God. I want to be a slave to God, a slave to holiness. Being separate from the word of God. I want to remind you again. Don't justify your wrongdoing. Don't justify other people's sin. Come out from sin. Call sin what it is. Verse 19. I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your flesh. Let me read this note to you. The manner of men, that phrase means, it pertains to the fall, which has made the flesh weak. This speaks of our own personal strength and ability. We fall because our own abilities are very weak. You can't depend on yourself to overcome and live according to the word of God in your own power. The devil is a liar. You need the power of the Holy Ghost to live according to the word of God. I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your flesh. For as you have yielded your members servants to uncleanness, don't yield yourself to uncleanness, unrighteousness, which is going against the word of God. And to iniquity unto iniquity. What does that mean? That means without constant faith in the cross, the believer's situation regarding sin would get worse and worse. We don't want to go deeper into sin. We want to come up out of it. So don't go from iniquity to iniquity. Go from iniquity to grace, the power of God, the ability of God to overcome that stronghold or that sin in your life. Give you an example, like gossip. Gossip is a spirit, is sin. You should not be gossiping. That is that the Bible talks about that. Watch the corrupt communication that comes out of your mouth. Don't let no corrupt communication come out of your mouth against anybody and even yourself. Let the word of God come out of your mouth. Sharper than any two-edged sword. Let me read the verse of the rest of verse 19. It says, even so now yield. Now he's telling us to come from unrighteousness, uncleanness, right? Now he's about to tell us what we should be doing. Even now, yield yourself, submit yourself, your members, servants. Even so now, yield your members, servants, to righteousness, unto holiness. Righteousness, which is living according to the word of God, that moves me into holiness. What is holiness? Being separate from the world, being consecrated unto God. So I go from righteousness, living according to the word of God, to being separate from the world. Why am I separate from the world? Because I understand the word of God now, because I'm living according to the word of God. And the word of God tells me to be separate from the world, which is a holy life. Come from among them. Be ye separate unto me, saith the Lord. Verse 20, for when you were the servants of sin, when you were, watch that past tense word, when you were the servants of sin, or the slaves of sin, you were free from righteousness. So he's saying that when you was in sin, you was free from the right thing. You was free from righteousness, which you were supposed to be doing. So when you was in sin, you was free from doing the right thing, which is incorrect. God want us to do. God want us to walk in righteousness, not be from it. Let's read it again. For when you were the servants of sin, you were free from righteousness. We don't want that. We want to be in righteousness. Verse 21. What fruit had you then in those things whereof you are now ashamed of? He said, what kind of fruit did you produce? Real fruit that is acceptable unto God. That what kind of fruit did you produce from your sin that you should be ashamed of now? Why? Because I can't believe that I lived that kind of life when God told me to live a clean, holy life, is what Paul is saying here. Let me read the verse, the latter end of that verse. It says, for the end of those things is death. Sin leads to death. We're about to read that. For the end of those things is death. What is the destination of sin? If things starts from flesh, then sin leads to death. Death, watch this. Death leads to hell, to the judgment of God, the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Excuse me, the second death is what I meant to say, the second death, which is being thrown into the lake of fire. Let's read verse 22. We're going to close with verse 23. Verse 22 says, but now, being made free from sin, now we are free. This is what we are declaring today in this video, in this message. We are free from sin in the name of Jesus. But now, being free from sin and become servants of God. I'm being free from sin, coming on, being converted from sin over from the flesh, excuse me, from sin from flesh over, being converted over on God's side. Righteousness, holiness, pureness, cleanness. And become servants to God, you have your fruit unto holiness. My fruit is in holiness. My fruit is the fruits of the Spirit. Patience, long-suffering, and etc. You have your fruit unto holiness. What is holiness again? Holiness is being separate from the world. I cannot do what the world do. In the latter part of that verse says, and the end, everlasting life. What would be the end of your fruit? The end of holiness, the end of righteousness. It would be everlasting life, having access or inheriting the kingdom of God. That's the whole goal of life. That I may enter into the kingdom of God. That I may bring pleasure to the Father. That I may enter and have access to the kingdom of God forever. Which is everlasting life, what we just read. Verse 23. For the wages of sin is death. So it says, for the wages of sin. So sin costs you. There's a price you pay for being in sin. And this is what I'm saying. You don't want to be in sin. There's a great price that you don't want to pay. Let me read this note to you. There's a cost for sin, and it's a price you don't want to pay, for the consequences are too great. Let me read the verse to you again. For the wages of sin is what? Death. For the wages of sin is death. Speaks of spiritual death, which is separation from God. But the gift of God, talking about salvation, but the salvation of God is eternal life, living for God. Living a life free from sin. But the gift of God is eternal life. Is present tense. Is talking about now. But the gift of God is eternal life. Saying now. The life that I live now for God will give me eternal life. Is what he's saying. But the gift of God is eternal life. That means making it into the kingdom of heaven. For eternity, forever. Eternal life through, but what is it through? How do I get there? It is through the Lord Jesus Christ, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. It is through Christ, the blood of Jesus, applying the blood of God to your life, getting out of sin, coming from among them who are in sin, who are bound, who are wicked, who are evil. It is through Jesus Christ. Let me give you these notes and I'm ending right here. God hates sin. You must hate sin. You must hate what God hates. God hates sin. It is not acceptable into the body, into the kingdom of God. It is the opposite of his nature. God's nature is holiness. Sin is the opposite of God's nature. We want to be like Christ, like God. Let me give you this last note. He can't condone sin in any degree. You must, by asking God to apply the blood of Jesus to your sins. That, my friend, is how sin is justified. Only God can justify. Romans 8:33. Only God can justify sin. Not you, not your mama, not your daddy. You can't justify your sin, and you can't justify God's. I mean, you can't justify other people's sins. Only God is able to do that by applying the blood of Jesus to our lives and to your life. Well, I'm going to end there. Look forward to part three. Then part three, most likely we will have part four. There's a lot on my mind that I want to share with you. But make sure that you look at part three. And again, don't forget to subscribe, hit the bell, share the video if you're being blessed by this message in the name of Jesus, in Jesus' name. For I pray that my words, my mouth becomes the very oracles of God. In Jesus' name, by the power of the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name. Look at part three. God bless you all. Bye-bye.